Hey folks, this is Best in Slot. Welcome back to our Mods of the Week Spotlight Series for Jurassic World Evolution 2. And I have a smorgasbord of new species for you to check out today. 14 new species in total, an incredible number. Two big packs in there, and then a bunch of individual creatures along the way. That's a lot to talk about, so we're going to streamline things. I'm going to try to keep it snappy, as you'll see throughout the video, but really exciting stuff. Mod community's gone absolutely bonkers this week, and I love to see it. Very quick disclaimer before we get started, mods can cause problems, particularly with loading old save files and stuff like that. We'll be talking about that a little bit more later in the week with RNG Park and stuff like that, because I keep having problems and I might just hold off for a little while. But if mods do cause problems, it's not my fault, it's not the mod maker's fault, and most importantly, it's not Frontier's fault. And that is about it. Don't really want to bury the lead anymore. Let's go check out our first new pack today. This is the Seas and Skies pack by Gushy Guar, Crassel Cog, Game Videos for Life, and in general, the Open Nausea modding community, although Gushy Guar was the author and producer. And we are starting with possibly the most interesting creature of the entire evening. This is Aegirocassis is what I'm going to go with. A giant arthropod from the early Ordovician era in Morocco. And that ages it, by the way, to a staggering 480 million years ago. This was a bizarre, gigantic filter feeder. Aegirocassis cassis was the largest animal from this time period at nearly 7 feet in length. Now, despite its huge age, you know, this thing is ancient to say the least, we actually have a surprisingly good idea of what it would have looked like. This is accurate to what this bizarre creature would have looked like. And you kind of see at the front there how it would use these little tendrils here to kind of filter feed. And it was one of the first large filter feeders out there. But the preservation of the specimens somehow, probably because it's in the water, despite being 480 million years old, we have really good 3D specimen preservation for Aegirocassis. So despite that age, we have a really good idea of what it looked like, and this is what it looked like. So it's very weird to think that sometime in the, well, a long, long, long time ago, nearly went into song then, things this bizarre were swimming around in our oceans. Now, our oceans still have some pretty bizarre stuff, but I think this would stand out as particularly weird. It's very, very cool. Brought to life so well by Gushy Guar and everyone else responsible, and really sells just how utterly strange and otherworldly this creature is. I'd love to spend all day watching it because I think it's really cool and really well integrated into the game, but we must move on. That was ruddy ominous. The second new creature in the Seas and Skies pack is the Creto I don't know how you pronounce it. X-Y-R-H-I-N-A. Creto Xrina. Anyways, it's a member of the Lamniformes, or the mackerel sharks, which includes sharks like the modern great white shark. This one, though, lived 170 million years ago during the late Cretaceous. Now, appropriately in size, in shape, you can kind of see it here already, in ecology, you know, in hunting and feeding habits and stuff like that, Creto would have been very, very similar to the modern great white shark. They were not dissimilar. You know, this was about 27 feet long or something like that, if I recall correctly. Not dissimilar to a modern great white. You know, it's not up there with your 50 feet long megalodons and the like. But just cool to have another shark. Of course, we've got that really interesting extra detail there, that extra sort of spike. Very pointy fin, I guess it is, at the front of the top dorsal fin there. Oh, and there they are snapping at each other a little bit. It looks really cool, really interesting texture, not the kind of patterning you would ever, I think, associate with a shark, because they tend to really go hard in on the counter shading. And we do have some counter shading going on here with that lighter white underbelly and then the sort of black dappled skin above, which would counter shade it pretty effectively. It would even sort of look like the dappling of sunlight, but then we get that lovely little extra detail. Again, really well modelled, and another really cool addition to the Seas and Skies pack. Well, we've seen the seas. Let's check out the skies. This is Darwinopterus, or it will be when I can zoom in. There we go. This is Darwinopterus looking fantastic there. Let me zip between a few of these. So I'm using the Open Aviary mod by Cowdenic. I figure that'll show them off a little bit better. So Darwinopterus, a Chinese tell you what, let's do slow motion. A Chinese pterosaur from the Middle Jurassic, likely fed on insects rather than, you know, fish or anything like that, given its body type and its habitat, would have hopped around from tree to ground to tree to ground to tree to ground in search for beetles to devour. Would have likely favored those hard-shelled beetles in terms of a food source. Darwinopterus is a transitional pterosaur. You can kind of see what I'm talking about here. It's got features from the Ramparhynchoids, that long tail in particular you'll associate with, say, Ramparhynchid, and then the pterodactyloids, your pterosaurs that came later on, your pteranodons and such, via this sort of longer neck vertebra. And also, you can't really see it because we can't see inside its head, but inside here it has a single skull opening, you know, the antorbital fenestra, etc., has a single skull opening in front of the eye, whereas the older pterosaurs, and like I said, this is transitional, so it's got features of both, would have had, you know, multiple openings, two openings there, rather than just one. Really interesting, let me just rotate myself here, really interesting here, this kind of almost watercolour pattern on the crest, and the way that sort of blends down into the beak is really, really interesting looking. I love that it's fully feathered or furry looking. It's got that kind of coating similar to your Dimorphodon, etc., and then this really lovely sort of almost leopard spot pattern across the wings. A really interesting looking pterosaur, very tiny little thing. Look at that one, that beautiful bright coloration. Again, that crest really standing out there. A very cool addition to the pack. And we have one more for the skies, and then, well, that doesn't seem to make sense, but you'll see what I mean in just a second. Let's check out the final flying member. So, quite a bit larger, and going a there you go, buddy. Going a little crazy there, but this is Phosphato Draco, an Atstarchid from the Late Cretaceous of Morocco. Phosphato Draco means the dragon from the phosphates, which is inherently pretty baller, I think you'll all agree. And that's an ode to the Ouled Abdoun Basin, where Phosphato Draco was discovered. And this is a geographical basin comprising 44% of Morocco's entire phosphate reserves. Now, Phosphato Draco is actually mid-sized as Atstarchids go. You know, this isn't your Hatzegopteryx or your Quetzalcoatlus in terms of size, but it still would have been a formidable terrestrial predator, stalking through vegetation for small dinosaurs and the like to snatch up. You know, it would have preferred to hunt waddling around on the ground rather than skimming through water or something like that, which is kind of what we thought Atstarchids would have done in the past. But again, another really, I love that this is all from one pack. You know, we've got this mix of the air and the sea, which is something neglected, I would say. You know, most mods are terrestrial dinosaurs, generally speaking. So it's really cool to see someone come in and focus on our aquatics and on our pterosaurs. And it's just another really beautiful looking Atstarchid. I tell you what, you can see there it feels quite a bit smaller. I'm just going to pull in a Quetzalcoatlus so you can just see, yeah, you can kind of see fairly, I mean, obviously the Quetzalcoatlus in this game is gigantic, way bigger than the actual creature would have been, but you can see there's a sizable difference there, and it's really cool to have an Atstarchid in the game, which is obviously much bigger than a lot of the pterosaurs, but isn't that humongous, and yet still has that Atstarchid body shape and would have had that Atstarchid movement, which we all pray we one day get in the game. So that's the seas and the skies. Now we do have one more creature to look at. It's a dual feature creature. That wasn't meant to rhyme. So it's got a lagoon variant, but we're going to check out the terrestrial version. So the final creature in Gushy Gua's Seas and Skies pack. Oh God. Well, I hope you understand why I chose to release this in terrestrial form. This is, where's my Tanistrophius? 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 Which is an archosauromorph reptile from the Triassic period. With a neck so long, it was longer than the torso and the tail combined, as you can probably tell. Now, Tanistrophius is another transitional creature. well adapted for both land and the sea. It probably did its hunting in the water. You can see it's got that really long neck, and in the water that's less of a detriment. We're thinking, you know, more like a plesiosaur, something like that, which uses that long neck in order to aid its hunting abilities whilst underwater. However, its limbs, you know, back here, these were better suited not really for swimming, but more for terrestrial movement. So I think the assumption is Tanystropheus would have mainly hunted in shallow waters, where it could have made a quick transition, I'm going to try to say that word again, a quick transition between land and water and back again, without having to overly commit to swimming, but still able to hunt in the water. It would have likely been an ambush predator, maybe lying in wait by the banks of the water and able to hunt into the water without having to fully commit to a full-on swim. Although it would have been capable of doing so, it just wouldn't have been absolutely adept at it. So there is an aquatic version of this included with the mod. I included the terrestrial version just because it looks utterly bizarre. It really does. Skinny worm sauropod hybrid kind of thing. It's very, very strange, and I love seeing this in its terrestrial form, so very glad that's included as part of it. And it makes sense for the creature as well, as I said, which would have definitely taken advantage of both mediums. Tanystropheus. So, that was the Season Skies pack by Gushy Guar, Frassel Cog, Game Videos for Life, and then they gave credit to a huge number of the Open Larger modding community who helped them bring it to life. Now next we are going to check out another pack. We're not going to go individual dinosaur detail this time around, just because there's only so much time in the world. This is but another really cool pack. This is the North American pack by Chocolate. Chocolate has returned. God bless Chocolate. And we have five new North American creatures. And the really cool thing about this pack, and we'll start over here with Velafrons, this hadrosaur. The really cool thing about this pack is there's so many of these dinosaurs that are, I would suggest, pretty obscure. I think I'd only heard of two or three of them. I definitely hadn't heard of all five. Hadn't heard of Velafrons, which is this very chunky hadrosaur. Not too dissimilar to our Corvosaurus, which might be the basal model underneath there. I don't know, but they've bugged it up something fierce. So we've got Velafrons, but we've also got a few others. We've got Cretosaurus over here, which is one of the few that I did know, very similar, as you can see, to our Montosaurus, but we've got that really bright, shockingly crimson sunburst sort of crest up there as well. This little dude next door, another thing I really like about this as well is we have, we've got ceratopsids. We never get ceratopsids anymore. It's such a rarity for mods or even the game itself to add ceratopsids. So this weird little fella is Menypheceratops, which, again, was actually a new dinosaur for me, which I really appreciate. I'm going to have to do a little work. Love that crest pattern there. It's like this war symbol kind of thing. Very intimidating. Big, bulky skull. Teeny tiny baby horns, but a gigantic beak there at the front. This thing is an absolute monster. And we've got another ceratopsid, Quahuili. Quahuili ceratops. More based on our penta, as you can see. None of them are too dissimilar to what we've already got in the game. You know, you can see the sort of underlying mechanisms of the dinosaur there, but there's definitely some remodeling going on. They feel very bulked up. They feel very vibrant in their coloration. This one, even with it going down the horns there. And then we have one more creature who's decided to take a nap. How do you pronounce T-L-A? Tlatolophus. Why would you put a T and L as the first two letters? That's silly. Maybe it's silent. Tlatolophus? Tlatolophus? Anyways, you need to wake up, buddy. There we go. Cryogenic speed one. Yeah, you can see this kind of droopy, thick banana kind of shape. I know all about it. And it's just there. It's prominent and it's really interesting looking. This bright blue, sort of baby blue sort of striping. And then this lovely patterning down along the body. And again, bulky and meaty in the way you kind of expect these large hadrosaurids to appear. A really cool, really unique pack, and you know, if it was any other week, I'd probably go into detail on all five dinosaurs, but we have so much to get through today. We've got four more to look at, although I've kind of zoomed through this much more. I guess that is 10 already, isn't it? Crazy. Well, I don't have any information, so we're just gonna have to get over it. But five really cool, really unique new dinosaurs to add to your game, you know, spice up your parks a little bit. The North America pack by Chocolate, highly recommend. Now, let's go back to our terrestrial dinosaurs to finish things off. So this very cool mod is just a little change by Mitchell Productions, and it is the novel Dilophosaurus. We've seen mods like this before, so I don't want to go into it too much, but I think this is the only one that actually works at the moment. And it just scales up the Dilophosaurus to look more akin to how it would in the novel, or indeed if the one from the film was full-sized. Of course it was a juvenile. I've come to accept that in the years since the video I did saying that it was full-size and just small. I've come to accept that they were juveniles. But in the novel, Dilophosaurus is like 20 feet long. In reality, of course, Dilophosaurus is much bigger than it is in the film as well. It's approximately the same size and would have looked something more akin to this without the big flappiness, basically. And yeah, this is by Mitchell Productions. It's really cool. They do a lot of lovely resizing and babies and stuff like that. Oh wait, yeah, one sec. A regular sized Dilophosaurus, and suddenly you've got like a little family unit kind of thing going on. Oh, and you decided to run off. Oh, at that exact time. Fantastic. Right, let's move on. Kind of adorable. So this penultimate mod is Zalmoxes by David has returned yet again. I think some of them are trapped in the hatchery, seemingly. Yeah, don't know what's going on there. They've all decided to stay in. Let me just give them a little hand. I think they need a little bit of help. There you go, guys, out your pop. Thank God for mods. So Zalmoxes, very, very cool, by, as I say, David. Of course, all these mods will be linked down below in the description. Should have mentioned that nice and early on. Zalmoxes is a rhabdodontid from late Cretaceous Romania, and of course seen recently going on a rafting adventure in prehistoric Planet 2, where it looked like a little hench dude, and as it does here as well. They always look like little hench dudes. Zalmoxes actually bounced around a lot when being described. I really like this one, this sort of bright green spotted pattern on the back looks really interesting. I'm going to grab you and move you actually. Zalmoxes bounced around a lot whilst being described. Originally it was named as a species of Mochlodon, and then later on it was renamed to a species of Rhabdodon, and then finally, only in the 2000s, was Zalmoxes invented, and it was given the name Zalmoxes after the Thracian deity Zalmoxes, who retreated into a crypt for years before finally emerging alive, just as Zalmoxes has kind of emerged from the paleontology graveyard, finally to become its own unique dinosaur. So a very, very cool name and a beautiful looking dinosaur, once again, by David. Zalmoxes is a pretty popular dinosaur when it comes to modding, but again, I can't think of any we've got right now, and this one's a really nice version. This one in particular, I just really, really like the patterning on the back there in particular, but they all look pretty cool. Nicely modelled, really interesting coloration. A lot of variety there in the coloration and the patterning as well. Just fits right into the game. Fits right into the grass as well. Very cute, and yeah, definitely a dinosaur I would like to see in the game by default, so it's really cool to have it in the game. Thanks to David. Next up, we have yet another basal sauropodomorph by Hokal1215. This is Lufengosaurus, a massospondylid from early Jurassic China. Now, a massospondylid are basal sauropodomorphs, as you can see from the bipedal nature of the body. And massospondylids just means it's closer in relation to Saltosaurus than to Plateosaurus. So, although it looks very similar to Plateosaurus in some ways, more similar to Saltosaurus, which is awesome, rather than Plateosaurus. I have nothing else to say about this. I've talked far too much about basal sauropods lately, which is pretty appropriate, it feels like. And yeah, it's got really interesting variety. Again, it's got tons of coloration. They always use the whole suite of the Color Core mod to have tons and tons of different color variations. So we've got this bright white into the orange, into the green. We've got this sort of browner coloration over here. We've got this sort of a monotone one with sort of like light blue speckles, baby blue speckles there. This much darker one with the brown speckles. All the speckles of the rainbow, folks. This one with the green around the head. Yeah, lovely variety, lovely texture as well. Really well modeled. You could build a really cool basal sauropodomorph kind of park at this point. Just download Hokal's mods and you'll have like 20 of the bloody things. proper horror movie stuff at the end there. So this is Borealosuchus by Hassan Wakatri, the back. God, my hatchery is freaking out today. A late Cretaceous crocodiliform from North America. This one also has an aquatic variant, just like the Tanistrophius that we saw a little bit earlier on. Borealosuchus was mid-sized, really, at about 15 feet long, and there is seemingly not that much else to say about this one. It just seems to be a fairly average crocodiliform for the time. It is worth noting, however, the newest species of Borealosuchus, there are six in total. Six species is quite a lot. It's called Threensis. And it was named in 2012 after its discovery in New Jersey. So why is it called Threensis? Which is a stupid name, as you'll see. And the reason is because the closest exit to the dig site where it was discovered. Also, just cool to find the dinosaur in New Jersey. Well, not a dinosaur, a crocodile form, you know what I mean. The nearest exit to the dig site was exit 3. And the author of the papers said this, that the name is in reference to a question every New Jersey resident encounters when traveling. Oh, you're from New Jersey? Which exit? So, I've never been to New Jersey. I've been to New York City, at least. But, yeah, you're trapped in there. Any of you who are from New Jersey, can you please verify that for me? Maybe that's a thing. I have no idea. Maybe that's a thing. I don't know. Either way, another really beautiful crocodile form here. We've been spoiled lately with the crocodile forms. And whilst they're not necessarily super visually distinct, all different, slightly different morphologies, slightly different body sizes, filling a slightly different ecological niche, which is really cool. And again, if you downloaded a bunch of them, you'd have a really awesome looking crocodiliform populated park, which sounds great in essence, really. And really like the coloration on this one, the sort of ombre effect between the black and the browns. Borealosuchus, also a cool name, the boreal crocodile. Everything I say rhymes today. So, 14 new species. We saw Aegis. Some people say Aegis. Aegis, as in like a shield. Aegirocassis, Cressox rhaena, no idea. Darwinopterus, Phosphatodraco, Tanistrophius, the entire North America Pacoquali, Ceratops, Crytosaurus, Menipheceratops, Tlatolophus, and Velophrons. We saw the Novelophosaurus, we saw Salmoxis, we saw Lufengosaurus, and we saw Borealosuchus. Bloody Nora. Huge shout out to all the mod makers for giving us these fantastic new species. As I say, all these mods will be downloaded down below. Even when it comes to the packs, you can pick and choose what you want to download. You don't have to have all five species. You could just pick your favorites. You know, maybe you just really want your long-necked weirdo. You know, maybe this is the only creature you want. Very understandably. But you can download the Season Skies pack and only install Tanistrophius, which I would recommend because look at it. It's fantastic. But yeah, really cool to see this mix. Really cool to have a new shark as well. Very cool. And a new Adstarchid as well, which we don't see very often, but I deeply adore Adstarchids. So very excited to see those added to the game. Shout out to mod makers. Go give the mod love in the world. Thank you for joining me very much. And, you know, let me know in the comment section down below, what was your favorite new species of today? Until next time, thanks for joining me. Cheers, much love as always. Bye-bye.